RNA viruses are recent, part two. We were going over last week a paper by E.C. Holmes in the Journal of Virology called Molecular Clocks in the Puzzle of RNA Virus Origins. It's available on the net, as most things are now if you know where to look for them. Just to summarize what it had to say, it's molecular clocks argue that viruses are recent, and standard phylogeny argues that they are ancient, and the question is, how do you solve this puzzle? And we're going to see how Holmes solves it and how I solve it, and more importantly, what kind of evidence we have behind the statements that Holmes makes. This, for what it's worth, is a quinine parvovirus, which can be gotten from virology, virology.wisconsin.edu, and some very nice viruses there. And it's available to be used by anybody who is not making money on it and is doing it for educational purposes. So we qualify at this point. So I'm going to start with a very quick summary of what the article said, and then we're going to look at the references that he uses, other references that might be appropriate, and finally one reference that cites, because most of the other ones cited exactly the same way, that cite his article. To start with, assuming an approximate molecular clock, it can be inferred that the families of RNA viruses circulating today could only have appeared very recently, probably not more than about 50,000 years ago. And in fact, if you read that section, you'll find that 50,000 is stretching it a bit. For example, the genus flavivirus, that's yellow fever, dengue, that kind of stuff, distance, a non-synonymous RNA bases, which means the more difficult ones to replace of the three groups is roughly 100-fold less than the DS, at approximately 0.2 substitutions per site, which would correspond to a divergence time of only about 10,000 years ago, assuming a non-synonymous rate of 10 to the minus 5 substitutions per site per year. Now, where does he get that 10 to the minus 5 substitutions per year? Well, we're going to come back to that in a little bit, and we're going to look at what it looks like in a real-time thing of influenza A virus. And we're going to find that 100-fold less may be a bit of an exaggeration, at least for that particular virus. To make the divergence of the flaviviruses correspond to the origin of the placental mammals at 100 million years would require a non-synonymous rate some 4 logs lower at 10 to the 9 substitutions per site per year. So what that's saying is that a liberal estimate of how slowly the viruses can change is 10 to the 4th times as fast as it needs to be to get back to the age of placental mammals, according to evolutionary theory. That's a major difference between the two. Simple molecular clock calculations suggest that the origin of RNA viruses is an extremely recent event. However, in some cases, such a recent origin conflicts with other evolutionary data. Maybe it'd be better to say it conflicts with evolutionary data. Perhaps the most notorious example is that of the primate lentiviruses, which includes human immunodeficiency viruses type 1 and 2, that's HIV for you, and a growing list of simian immunodeficiency viruses. Immunodeficiency viruses that afflict monkeys and apes that infect a wide variety of African monkeys and, I would have to say, apes. A similar disparity between divergence time, that's what you would get from a molecular clock, and phylogenetic history can be seen for hepatitis B virus. While not strictly an RNA virus, hepatitis B replicates using reverse transcriptase, and so also is likely to evolve rapidly. Evolution of viruses happens extremely rapidly. It is difficult to see how these viruses could be so widely dispersed unless they had undergone co-speciation with their hosts or were spread much more recently by humans. That's an interesting thing in parenthesis. So maybe they were spread by humans without realizing it. However, as with the primate lentiviruses, the best estimates of substitution rates suggest an evolutionary history of only a few thousand years and many orders of magnitude too recent for co-speciation. There is a conflict between the theory that's required to explain why viruses match their hosts, which requires an evolutionary perspective according to them, and the evidence from the viruses themselves would suggest something much more recent. Importantly, the discrepancy between phylogenetic evidence for long-term co-speciation and recent molecular clock dates is also seen for GBVC, hepatitis G virus, the New World hantaviruses, family of Bunyaviridae, and the arenaviruses. Three different other besides HIV, and the plant tobamoviruses as well. Whatever the virus, the problem is the same. This is not an isolated incident. This is something that happens all the time. If the inferred history of long-term virus host co-speciation is correct, then the rates of nucleotide substitution in these viruses must be far lower than those reported for other RNA viruses. That is, they don't mutate as fast as experimentally shown. Otherwise, their gene sequences would be unrecognizably divergent. Now, in that last sentence, what it is saying is that their gene sequences are not unrecognizably divergent. And yet, by standard evolutionary theory, they should be. We have a problem here. At face value, there are three explanations for the apparent discrepancy between the very recent molecular clock estimates for RNA virus origins and the phylogenetic evidence for virus host co-speciation over millions of years. The most obvious is that the molecular clock is not constant and the rates of nucleotide substitution have changed dramatically. That's proposal number one. An important example of such a change in substitution rate is provided by influenza A virus. Although synonymous substitution rates in influenza A viruses from aquatic birds, horses, pigs, and humans vary no more than is usual among RNA viruses, the non-synonymous rate is greatly reduced for the avian virus compared to that seen for human viruses. We're going to see some for human viruses. Whether such differences in non-synonymous substitution rates are typical of RNA viruses that switch hosts clearly requires further investigation. Okay. Other than the debated case of GBVC, there is little evidence that overall substitution rates, that is for synonymous and non-synonymous sites combined, are orders of magnitude lower than 10 to the minus 3. That's because usually the synonymous swamp the non-synonymous. And hence sufficient to greatly extend viral divergence times. In other words, you can't explain a solution to the problem of fast virus evolution versus it must have taken millions of years because they co-varied with their species, with the host species. You can't explain it well with non-synonymous rates because they're not those orders of magnitude lower than 10 to the minus 3. A continual accumulation of amino acid changes through time has been observed in a variety of RNA viruses. It does change experimentally, and experimental studies have provided little evidence for stasis in RNA virus evolution. It doesn't happen the way they say. Living fossils, like the coelacanth, have undergone very little morphologic change over long periods of time, suggesting they are at an adaptive peak, but similar rates of nucleotide substitution, but have similar rates of nucleotide substitution to other vertebrates. Evolution experimentally is going on in coelacanths right now. But it looks like they haven't changed. Why haven't they changed? Well, of course, one answer is that maybe there isn't that much time that has gone by since, let's say the Mesozoic or the Paleozoic. And that's why they haven't changed. But I don't think the author is going to go there. Perhaps the most likely way that clock rates could vary between RNA viruses is if there are major differences in rates of replication, that is, in virus generation times. The human T-cell lymphotrophic virus types 1 and 2, these were discovered when they were trying to find HIV. They were discovered first. HTLV 1 and 2. In epidemic situations where transmission rates are high, replication rates are rapid. However, in regions of endemicity, the substitution rate is reduced to about 10 to the minus 9 substitutions per site per year, which is the human substitution. And apparently the reason for that is that the virus gets incorporated into infected cells in their DNA and then stays that way for a while. And, of course, when it's incorporated into the DNA, basically it doesn't change significantly. A second explanation for the recent origin of RNA viruses is that the methods currently used to estimate evolutionary distances from gene sequences are flawed in some way. And basically, that's kind of a reworking of the first way, that there's differences in the non-synonymous substitution rates, or distances if you prefer, DN, that all DNs are not alike, and since they're heterogeneous themselves, then maybe some of them get hung on to longer than others. And so you don't change everything quite as fast as you'd expect. A gamma distribution in which a sequence alignment is divided into a number of classes, and that's particularly, you know, for the non-synonymous substitution rate. Theoretically, however, it is possible to obtain ancient divergence times for RNA viruses simply by employing extremely skewed gamma distributions. Theoretically, that is. The problem, of course, is that the alpha values estimated using the analytical methods available at present, that is, the current data we have, are a long way from the extremely biased values required to produce such ancient divergent sites. Makes a nice theory, but when you check it out, the evidence isn't there. In fact, there's evidence against it. The final explanation for the recent origin of RNA viruses is that this is, in fact, what happened. The key to this hypothesis is that the molecular clock dates discussed throughout this paper only relate to the RNA viruses currently circulating, that is, those that have been identified for the last 100 years or so. Indeed, the tree of all RNA viruses is highly distinctive in that it is composed of relatively close tips representing members of each viral family connected by internal branches of generally unquantifiable length, which sounds an awful lot like an orchard rather than a tree. However, one major problem remains. How can we explain the match between virus and host phylogenies that has been taken as evidence for co-speciation over millions of years? And he proposes two models, and he says about each of those models, unfortunately, while both models are possible, they currently lack clear empirical support. Now, it seems like when we get done with reading that, he doesn't have a really good answer, right? And he proposed what it needs to be done, as this review has highlighted, there is currently no all-encompassing explanation for why the molecular clock dates of RNA viruses are so recent. Well, actually, there is. But so recent, given the fact that it must have been very old since the viruses diverged from each other. That's the problem. However, it is possible to identify areas where future research might be expected to clarify the situation. First, it is obviously important to obtain more accurate estimations of substitution rates in a wider variety of RNA viruses. So we're going to estimate what the substitution rates are for both synonymous and non-synonymous sites. And then more studies of RNA viruses, evolution in animal and plant populations are required. Maybe we need to differentiate those non-synonymous into different classes themselves. And finally, it is clear that we need new models of sequence evolution that incorporate the idiosyncrasies of RNA virus evolution. Maybe the gamma distribution isn't good enough. We need more study there. Now, I want you to notice that, because we're going to come back to that, that he hasn't really answered the problem. He has called attention to some things that might possibly explain it, but he hasn't really got a good explanation for the question he started out with. We have a question back there. Well, that's so we can hear you. Good.
About three screens back, the first sentence seemed to be the fact. And he's trying to explain away what appears to be the fact.
That's true.
Fit his theory.
That's true. The facts conflict with evolutionary theory, and so we got to explain away those facts. Well, let's go back to some of the evidence here. This is in PM et al., Origin and Evolution of AIDS Viruses, Estimating the Time Scale. This is one of the evidences that he cites for his paper. And excuse me so that you can, those of you who want to, can look this up. If you're getting the email, that link is in it already. And I'll just read the abstract. The primate lentiviruses comprise SIV strains from various host species as well as two viruses, HIV-1 and HIV-2, that cause AIDS in humans. The origins of HIV-1 and HIV-2 have been traced to cross-species transmissions from chimpanzees and Suri mangabey monkeys, respectively. Two approaches have been taken to estimate the time scale of the evolution of these viruses. Certain groups of SIV strains appear to have evolved in a host-dependent manner, implying a time scale of many thousands or even millions of years. In stark contrast, the molecular clock calculations have previously been used to estimate a time scale of only tens or hundreds of years. So, yeah, there's a problem in HIV and related viruses. These calculations largely ignored heterogeneity of evolutionary rates across different sites within sequences. In fact, the distribution of rates at different sites seemed extremely skewed in HIV-1, and so the time depth of the primate lentivirus evolutionary tree may have been underestimated by at least a factor of 10. However, these data estimates still seem far too recent to be consistent with host-dependent evolution. So in the lentiviruses, he's just documenting the problem that Holmes talked about earlier. Time scale, in the absence of a fossil record, two main approaches have been used. Now, obviously, the best thing to do would be to have HIV from 40 million years ago or whatever, but that's not going to happen. In the absence of that fossil record, two main approaches have been used in attempts to establish timescales for viral evolution. For rapidly evolving viruses, it is possible to calculate their rate of evolution by comparison of viruses isolated at different time points, and then to use this molecular clock to estimate the dates of divergence within the evolutionary tree. An example, a person who got HIV, you draw blood, you wait 2, 3, 8, whatever, however many years they last, years later, and you draw it again, and you measure how much change has happened in the HIV that was in their blood to begin with. The other approach has been to find instances where viruses appear to have been evolving in a host-dependent manner, that is, without transmission between different species of hosts. In such cases, the divergence time of hosts also pertain to their viruses. You can use experimental data to estimate how fast viruses evolve. You can use evolutionary data to explain how fast viruses evolve. Both techniques have been adopted to estimate the time scale of primate lentivirus evolution. Some of the earliest attempts in 1988 yield dramatically discordant results. Concordant within themselves, more or less, but discordant with each other. One attempt to use a molecular clock estimated that the common ancestor of HIV and HIV-1 and HIV-2 existed as recently as 1951. At the same time, after comparison of HIV-1 with an SIV from an African green monkey, others suggested that it was possible that a common ancestor of these viruses infected the common ancestor of apes and old world monkeys. That ancestor is thought to have lived at least 25 million years ago. Let's see. Back up there. You can choose between 1951 or 25 million years. That's a bit of a spread. Thus, the two different approaches led to estimates with a discrepancy of about 6 orders of magnitude. They're off by a million times. We use the rate of non-synonymous substitution in the pole gene to estimate the time of the common ancestor. So they're using non-synonymous, the DN that we've heard about before, and they're using a particular gene called the pole gene. Looks like I've the common ancestor of HIV-1, HIV-2, and SIV-AGM at about 150 years ago. That's all one paragraph. These two approaches to estimating the time scale of primate lentivirus evolution yield highly discordant results. The number of primate species now known to be infected by their own specific HIV and the apparently host-dependent evolution of certain clades of HIV strongly suggest that the primate lentiviruses as a whole cannot have evolved only within the last millennium. It's been well over 1,000 years. This indicates that the time scale suggested from the molecular clock is most likely to be a gross underestimate. Well, or else the other approach is invalid. And another reference that he uses, Cheryl Arin et al. And again, this one is available on the internet if you know where to look. Between 35 and 6 million base pair, million years before present. This rate is 3 × 10⁻⁸ amino acid substitutions per site per year. In the last 150,000 years, the rate of evolution of human GBVC increased. This is discussing GBV. That's sort of like hepatitis G virus. Increased to 3 × 10⁻⁷ amino acids per site per year, which is still very, very slow. Remember that most of them are around 3 × 10⁻³ or thereabouts. Nakao et al. Reported a higher rate of evolution, 2 × 10⁻⁴, which is more typical, based on analysis of virus sequences obtained from a hemodialyzed patient over an 8.4-year follow-up. Well, now that's direct experimental evidence, so to speak. You get blood from 8.4 years ago, you get blood from now, you compare the sequence and you say it must have evolved that fast. Seems like experimental evidence should trump everything else, right? Well, however, it has been demonstrated that extrapolation of the rate of non-synonymous substitution over a short period of time to reconstruct the history of viruses may tend to estimate the actual time of divergence. Probably because this kind of study does not take into account inter-individual virus transmission, which is a crucial parameter of virus dynamics. Wait a minute. This is estimating in one patient how fast the virus changes. If you take a sample of that and put it into another person, or monkey, or whatever, and then you allow it to pass to another, and another, and another, every time you pass it, you're going to take stuff from the original, which is whatever it is. You can't slow it down by doing that. If anything, you would be speeding it up. This does not make sense.
It's as if you're thinking that the virus spent some time between individuals.
Well, even if the virus spent time in between individuals, it can't slow it down much. Unless it's spending time, let's say, somewhere where it sits for 5 years without evolving at all. That's what you have to do in order to slow it down.
Stasis.
So it seems like, if anything, the estimate of what happens in a particular patient should give an underestimate of this, of the speed of evolution rather than an overestimate. But that's how, you know, when they run into things, there's got to be an explanation, and so they'll reach for the best explanation they can think of. And here's another one with a slow evolutionary rate of GBE virus, C, hepatitis G virus. And again, this is available on the internet for those of you who want to look it up. Then the rate was estimated to be 0.8 to 1.9 times 10 to the minus 3. By Matsuko et al. In 1996, and 3.9 times 10 to the minus 4, Nakao, that's the one we just saw, which are, well, really, this is 8 to 10, or 3.9, or basically 4, which, you know, I suppose it depends on what your assumptions are. That kind of change is kind of would be understandable, but they relatively match each other, indicating that GBV C slash hepatitis G virus evolved with an extremely high rate. In fact, it was a rate similar to or slightly slower than that of HCV hepatitis C virus. So it matches. Okay, 0.2 to 7.51 times 10 to the minus 3. What we're looking at is something that actually kind of fits other viruses. And let me just show you what other viruses we're talking about. Hepatitis C, hepatitis D, HIV-1, actually a little worse than the rest of them, probably because it has to escape the immune system. Influenza A, which is probably for the same reason, a little faster. Now notice that mammals are down at 10 to the minus 9. And notice that GBV, HCV is, in this study, is way down there. The other people who did it experimentally found it was just like all the other viruses. Okay? So, but there's a conflict between the evolutionary and hepatitis G virus. There's a conflict between the evolutionary age and the direct measurements of how fast the thing evolves, how fast it changes. Maybe change is better put them evolved because evolution in most people's minds means going to something better, whereas this is simply change. Now, at this point, I've stopped looking at some of their stuff, and I'm going to look at some other material that might be worthwhile paying attention to. This is Robert Carter and John Sanford. Some of you have heard of John Sanford, I'm sure. And in fact, some of you may have heard of this paper, New Look at an Old Virus in Theoretical Biology and Medical Modeling. And there's a long thing to download. But you can get the paper. And I'm just going to show you some of the pictures because they really answer the questions. You'll notice that there is the number of changes from a baseline virus forms a fairly close straight line, where 75% of the Y value spread is explained in terms of the X value. That's pretty good. And if you look at an even larger picture where we have viruses, you'll notice that you have a very straight line here, and then you have a beginning here. This one apparently was caused by a laboratory that had him in had the virus in the refrigerator, and somehow it got out and started infecting people again. And you can see that you have again the same straight line, only moved over. And if you move all of that stuff back together again, you get an extremely straight line with 98%+, almost 99% of the X of the vertical values being explained in terms of where they are horizontally. That's a remarkable R. Interestingly, that is all of them. Here is the DN, the non-synonymous mutations. And you will notice that it's a much flatter slope, but it is still a very good slope. 94% of the Y is explained by X. And what's even more interesting is that this is 14.4, this is 2.4, so it's roughly 1/6 of the slope of the other one. That is to say, it hasn't even dropped by a full order of magnitude. Which means that when they say, well, it goes from 10 to the minus 3 to 10 to the minus 5, it really should be probably 10 to the minus 4, at least in the case of of influenza A, which is interesting. I'd like to see that same graph done on hepatitis. It would be an interesting graph, or perhaps HIV. I suspect that the non-synonymous substitution rates that they're using, that they want to get down to 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 6, are just not compatible with virus physiology. Now, what's even more interesting is how Holmes is cited. Remember, Holmes came to the conclusion that there were a few possible explanations and that we needed more research, but they didn't really have the answer, right? Okay, here's just to give you one example, but there are several other, there are about 300 examples, and most of them use it the same way. Sharp PM and Han BH, so it's not the same people, so you can't just say Holmes is citing himself. Again, this is available on the internet. Skipping past a couple of paragraphs, lentiviruses cause chronic persistent infections in various mammalian species, including bovines, horses, sheep, felines, and primates. Remember, lentiviruses are the ones that have HIV, among others. The great majority of lentiviruses are exogenous, meaning that they are transmitted horizontally between individuals. However, it has recently become clear that on several occasions in the past, lentiviruses have infiltrated their host's germlines and have become endogenous, vertically transmissible genomic loci. So that's a possibility of how you can get viruses that don't change. They get into the human genome, and then they change as rapidly as the human, or chimpanzee, or African green monkey, or whatever. Examples include the rabbit endogenous lentiviruses type K, relic, which became germline embedded approximately 12 million years ago, according to Katsourakis 2007 and van der Leeuw et al. In 2009. And two prosimian endogenous lentiviruses, which independently invaded the germlines of both the gray mouse lemur and the fat-tailed dwarf lemur. That'd be an interesting study in and of itself. Notice none of them have to do with humans, chimpanzees, or other monkeys. These are prosimians and lemurs and so forth. These viral fossils are particularly interesting because they provide direct evidence of the timescale of lentivirus evolution. Molecular clocks derived from extant SIV sequences suggested that ancestral SIVs existed only a few hundreds of years ago, Wertheim and Werby in 2009, but it has long been suspected that, notice that this is after Holmes. Okay. But it has long been suspected that such analyses may grossly underestimate deeper evolutionary timescales. Sharp et al., 2000, and Holmes, 2003. Wait a minute. Holmes, 2003, is being used to prove that such analyses may grossly underestimate deeper evolutionary timescales. Therefore, they can't be accurate? That's what the paper said, I guess. I thought the paper said it doesn't know why this doesn't work. But, you know, it's just interesting to see how the paper is being used. If we've read the paper and now we've come to a site, if you had read that site, would you have been able to recreate the paper from the site, or even the main point of the paper? I guess maybe you could if you knew that evolution had to be true and so everything has to be fit around it. I think that, you know, what this is telling you is you have people for whom evidence doesn't matter. As far as the truth of evolution is concerned, you don't need evidence. If you have contradictory evidence, it doesn't matter. Recent studies of SIV-infected monkeys on Bioko Island, Equatorial Guinea, partially substantiated this conclusion that you can't trust the molecular clock. You remember how good that molecular clock was? You saw the pictures. That was really, really good. 99% of the variants can be explained on the basis of the time frame. That's a pretty good clock. It really is. But the conclusion they've drawn is that, no, it's not any good. And why is it not any good? Showing that geographically isolated subspecies have been infected with the same type of SIV for at least 30,000 years and probably much longer. Now, of course, if you're a creation scientist, you're going, how do they know it's 30,000 years? Well, because evolution tells them it has to be. Doesn't that mean evolution is conflicting with an empirically derived fact? Again, it doesn't matter. The endogenous viruses in lemurs reveal that the span of evolutionary history of primate lentiviruses as a whole is at least two orders of magnitude greater still. We know that this is the way evolution worked. And so those things just have to be older, and the fact that they look young doesn't matter. Thus, it is possible that at least some SIVs, such as those infecting four closely related species of African green monkey, Chlorocebus species, have co-evolved with their respective hosts for an extended period of time, and in an extended period of time, we're talking millions of years, perhaps even before these hosts diverged from their common ancestor. That's way back. So far, SIV infections have only been found in African monkeys and apes, and so it seems likely that the primate lentiviruses emerged in Africa sometime after the split between lineages of African and Asian Old World monkeys, which are believed to have occurred about 6 to 10 million years ago. So you see, the evolutionary data just proves that it has to be older than 6 to... that it has to be younger than 6 to 10 million years ago, but older than a million years ago by a long shot. However, because neither Asian nor New World primates have been sampled exhaustively, the conclusion that SIVs are restricted to African primates must remain tentative, especially because none of these primate species have been examined for endogenous forms of SIV. So we haven't even checked to see whether SIV is in the genomes of these monkeys or apes. Thus, our understanding of the evolutionary history of primate lentiviruses is still incomplete. So we have to understand the evolutionary history, but where it conflicts with the experimental data, evolution triumphs. What I find is particularly interesting is that later in this article, you'll notice that they have completely disregarded the experimental data. But where it doesn't conflict with evolutionary theory, they believe it. Phylogenetic analyses of full-length SIV gorilla sequences confirmed this conclusion, indicating that SIV gorilla resulted from a single chimpanzee to gorilla transmission event estimated to have occurred at least 100 to 200 years ago. That's not done in evolutionary theory. That's done on virus divergence. So 100 to 200 years ago, maybe a little longer, a chimpanzee gave a gorilla, I don't know, maybe it got eaten by the gorilla. Maybe they had sex. Who knows what? They did. One thing I'm pretty sure is they didn't share needles from intravenous drug abuse. But somehow, a chimpanzee gave a gorilla HIV, or actually SIV gorilla, SIV chimpanzee, which turned into SIV gorilla. And the two are divergent enough that that's happened some 100 to 200 years ago, maybe a little further. You can show that by the sequence comparisons of SIV chimpanzee and SIV gorilla. That one will be accepted without asking too many questions. But that's because the gorilla is recent and raises a question. Maybe those other ones were also transmitted the same way. Chimpanzees, for example, are known to eat monkeys of various species. There's no reason why chimpanzees couldn't have acquired the virus from eating infected mangabey meat or green monkey or something. Anyway, then this whole thing needs to be put into a context because there's more to this than just RNA viruses. It turns out to be true in humans as well. When a molecular clock conflicts with evolution, be it ever so good, that molecular clock can be disregarded. And I'm going to give you the classic example, R.L. Kahn et al. In 1987, mitochondrial DNA in human evolution, where it states that mitochondrial DNAs from 147 people all stem from one woman who is postulated to live about 20,000 years ago. Well, that was uncomfortable enough, but Parsons, T.J. et al., 1997, and again, this is available on the online, wrote an article in which they said, using our empirical rate to calibrate of DNA changes in human mitochondria, to calibrate the mitochondrial DNA molecular clock would result in an age of the mitochondrial DNA most recent common ancestor of only about 6,500 years ago, clearly incompatible with the known age of modern humans. 6,500 years ago. That's not close to anything you've heard of, is it? Yeah, 6,000 years ago, 7,500. Yeah, I could buy that. While our results are at odds with those of phylogenetic studies, that's the evolutionary studies, they are in excellent agreement, I think that's my typo, with a recent report that also directly measured CR substitution rate, and they give a reference. So, in other words, ours are not bizarre. They actually fit in with other data that we have for RNA. They're experimentally verified, but they don't fit the evolutionary time scale. And although there's a lot more to be said about human Y chromosome, and eventually we should go into that in some depth, there's an interesting article by Adore et al. In 2007, Absence of Polymorphism at the ZFY Locus on the Human Y Chromosome in Science, which, again, you can get on the internet. And DNA polymorphism in the Y chromosome examined at a 729 base pair intron, so it should not be sensitive to small changes, located immediately upstream of the ZFY zinc finger exon, revealed no sequence variation in a worldwide sample of 38 human males. This particular sequence, they took 38 males and they were going to find out, you know, how much mutation there was between them. And in this sequence, there was zero in 729 base pairs. Now, I would not want to be one to claim that that's the standard, but what that does suggest is that maybe there hasn't been quite as much change as what has been suggested. Interestingly enough, the article goes on to say that this shows that males were that all males had the same DNA, depending on the model, 27 or 270 million years ago, something like that. Which, of course, we don't know. It could have been zero from that data. But that's the way it goes. The evidence that we've seen seems to indicate that properly calibrated molecular clocks are quite good. You saw that in influenza A. It's very good if it's used in an appropriate way. It also seems to indicate that the evolutionary time scale conflicts with experimental time scales. Our first article, I think, is pretty definite about that. Evolutionists are happy to use molecular clocks as long as they do not conflict with the evolutionary time scale. Then they dump the clocks in favor of their time scale. You know, ignoring evidence like that, they must be creation scientists. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
Just one clarification here. Why have they not fallen back on the idea, well, maybe these are just recent infections from a virus that became adaptable to that particular situation. Is it so pervasive that it doesn't fit, or?
Well, what it requires is for viruses to move all the way from one end of Africa to the other. I would be interested to see whether you could. Apparently, New World monkeys are not involved in this, and therefore, you'd have to, if you're a good evolutionary theorist, you have to put the origin of the virus after the split up of Gondwanaland.
I'm misunderstanding something, I suspect. But these days, we know that viruses can spread very readily, easily. In fact, anytime there is an epidemic anywhere on the planet, everybody becomes alerted everywhere.
Right, just like the Zika virus.
Yes, why? Because we know that the transmission can be very easy.
Well, of course,
and just because it's not in one host and it is in another simply means that that particular virus does not survive very well in a particular host.
Right.
That's not a novel finding. Most viruses have certain preferred hosts and they don't do very well in others.
Yeah. And in fact, if you're from Missouri, you know this very well. If you go out picking berries or something like that, you will come back, if you don't spray yourself with DEET first, with a whole bunch of bite marks around your waistline. What those are is those are mites of the same general kind that cause scabies. But they do it in deer instead of in people. And what happens is that they can crawl in and they can bite, but they can't. The immune system kills them off fairly rapidly, so you get this line of you get this line of bite marks, and then you know in a week or two they're all gone. I don't know. Do they have those in West Virginia? They call them chiggers.
Oh, chiggers!
Yes, Michigan too.
Michigan. So it's fairly common. It's you know, they live in one host. They do try to move to the new host, but it doesn't work out very well. I mean, it doesn't work out very well for the people who get it, of course, but it works out even worse for the chiggers who are trying to survive. So, yeah, you do have organisms that try to infest one host after another one. And it doesn't work out. And it raises the interesting question, could you have a mutant that somehow managed to survive on the person, and then would it take off from there? Could deer mites have evolved from human mites? That would be scabies. Or vice versa. And I suppose that's a possibility. And one should be able to find out what the mutation rate for mites is, and what the mutation rate, and the genetic distance between the two, and if they're close enough that it could have happened within the last whatever, you would say, well, maybe they did evolve from the same species, and it just happened that, you know, one of the mutants wouldn't have done very well on the deer mice, on the deer, but does do well on the people.
I'm just curious. What is the percentage of non-synonymous differences in these different viruses? And they talk like the different lentiviruses and so on. Roughly, certainly it's not the 10 to minus, well, 50. That they were talking about for total change.
It would be now. That's a question that it requires somebody who can go back to the original data, and run percentages, and I think that would be a useful exercise. I Don't know that I have time.
Your
to
chart
do that today,
said relative numbers. They used relative numbers there on the left. There, you remember that where you had those two.
Just things. A minute. We're I think we lost power on this mic here. Do we have another battery or? Anyway, I would say that the now it's back. Try it again. Go ahead.
You know that slide where you had the beautiful curves there, you know, with that
little
jack. It said relative on the side, so I couldn't tell how much change does that represent.
Well, you have to say change from what, and so there's a baseline sequence that they're measuring the change from. And I don't know what that. I don't know where they got that baseline sequence. Maybe that's the best convergence they can get from 1919 or so.
Yeah.
And it so happens that it goes out in the. You know, it's actually a multidimensional cone that you're looking at rather than a straight line, because the straight line can only measure one dimension. But it spreads out in all different directions. And, you know, given that there's... let's say if you have 1,000 bases, you have a 1,000-dimensional cone that you're measuring.
It seems to me, as we look at this picture here, we need to keep in mind these folks think they're absolutely honest, they're sincere.
Sure.
They don't think they are deceiving. They think that creationists do that perhaps more, and that I challenge them on.
That's why I say it's kind of interesting, because what it boils down to is it's a very procedure that they accuse your creation scientists of using. We'll use the molecular clock whenever it makes sense, and then when we run into problems with the evolutionary timescale, we'll say, well, it doesn't really count.
It's because they consider creation an impossibility.
Yeah, and evolution must... And the time is just fixed. It's just fixed. I have a comment up here, I think.
I might have a slight advantage, and that's based on ignorance, because I don't fully understand what RNA and DNA and viruses and retroviruses, how they all fit together. So my advantage is I can leap into theology and maybe look at it from a theological viewpoint. I'm thinking of how a progressive creationist might handle this data. And some of the people in ASA, American Scientific Affiliation, might seize upon this and say, hey, we don't have a problem with what you've presented, because we can factor in the effects of the fall. And the fall in Eden happened recently, whereas you have, you know, a long history for fossil record. Have you seen anything in the literature that might say we can accept what you presented here as a short time scale? You know, I see 10,000 years, I see 6,500 years, I see 50,000. Okay, somewhere in there is the fall of Adam and Eve, when all of these ill effects were released into this world, and you could have a very slow environmental change and, you know, DNA change over a long period prior to that time. So I'd like to hear you speculate, since I've speculated. I'd like to hear what you might speculate on this.
Well, I will say, first of all, that I don't see many speculations in that regard from the American Scientific Affiliation. My sense is that the American Scientific Affiliation does very little to try to explain standard science, and by that I mean not only evolutionary science, but all the other sciences put together, the package that is sometimes called science, which of course I would strongly object to trying to make them all equally authoritative. But so I don't see them actually dealing with this question at all. I haven't seen anybody that tried to deal with it, and I haven't seen similar type of questions being dealt with. The American Scientific Affiliation, generally speaking, doesn't even, it's whatever the scientific community says must be right, and because they're unbiased. Whereas creationists, as everybody knows, are biased. And so we have no right to do any kind of corrective to science because we've got an agenda to push, and they don't.
A good person to ask along this line of progressive creationism or even theistic evolution would be Francis Collins. I'm just wondering if anyone of his stature in the scientific world has even thought of what you are dealing with.
I don't think so. I may be wrong. I'd be delighted to be wrong, but I have not yet seen any of them directing any fire at the standard. I think they're caught in this thing of you can't use God of the gaps. And because you can't use God of the gaps, that means God can't appear anywhere. And that means that you perform science as if God didn't exist.
Right.
And so basically, when you're a scientist, you're an evolutionist. You're not an evolutionist, you're an atheist. You're an effective atheist. God doesn't appear, period.
Methodological.
And in fact, and methodologically, they will say this is what you should be seeing.
True.
And they will just be very upfront about that. And then afterwards they'll say, but God planned it this way. And it gets to be very, can God plan an unplanned process?
So what you need to do, this is fascinating to me, is it does have a lot of theological implications. What you need to do is get this out into the scientific arena, publish it, even if in a creationist journal, but even publish it on the web, and then start some dialogue going. Is I think you could have immediate response.
Well, we will find out, as we are, as of course you know, publishing this on the web.
Yeah.
It will be on this afternoon.
That's true. I think
it would be nice to have it in writing somewhere.
Yeah, you need to widen the arena.
Yeah. Well, we'll start where we are and then move on from there. But this is worth a paper in Origins, I would think.
Yeah, somewhere. Good.
No, it's very interesting because you bring up the theological end of it, and the American Scientific Affiliation basically is scared of its own shadow when it comes to science. They're not willing to predict anything because they'll be shot down. And as long as you accept the scientific community's word as being gold, and as long as the scientific community is committed enough to their theory that experimental evidence just falls off its back, and nobody asks, well, maybe it isn't that old, then you're never going to get a corrective. So what effectively has happened is that the theistic evolutionists who won't stand up and say, well, God acted here, basically are reduced to accepting the entire evolutionary scenario in toto. You notice that Francis Crick won't even criticize him on the basis of the origin of life. And that's a slam dunk. And the reason he won't is because any attempt to say that modern science has got it wrong is doomed to failure, because science will eventually find an explanation. And while they're waiting for the explanation, that eventually finding one will dominate. And once they get there, if we've stood against him, we're going to wind up with egg on our faces. And so let's just get out of that position to begin with, so we never have to challenge them.
To enlarge on what you just said, you go back to the beginning and you look at how did the first living cell originate spontaneously, or how did DNA create itself? Well, the theistic evolutionist has a paradigm that wherever you look, you can have a rational explanation, but you can also put God into the picture behind the scenes. So you could actually put God in with the very first cell, in that he put all the materials here and then let chance take over. That's how they would probably explain that. Francis Collin would probably say, I have no problem with chance. But God, you know, is still in the background.
Background. Any proposal that says that this is too big for law and chance is setting you up for failure.
Exactly. Yeah.
And, you know, I wrote an article about that. It was called, Does Religion Always Lose? And the interesting thing is, you can demonstrate that religiously oriented ideas don't always lose. That what happens is usually the scientific community just kind of absorbs them. Sometimes they can't absorb them, and they spend the rest of their lives fighting them. The origin of life is one of those. And so science will say, we never lost. And the reason why we never lost is because either we eventually won, which they do sometimes. I think that Galileo was right, and the earth moves and the sun is relatively stationary, at least as far as the solar system is concerned, and so forth. Or we lose the popular battle, and we may still be right, but nobody wants to admit it. Or they are losing, but they don't admit it yet, because someday we'll find it. So what it boils down to is they can't lose, because either they will win outright and we'll admit it, or they will win and we won't admit it. That's from their viewpoint. Or they will be losing, but you can't count those because they may still win. And I think that's not the right way to look at things. That there are some things that we want, and they just never want to say anything about it. The existence of Belshazzar being one of the best examples. Granted, that's archaeology and not science in the strictest sense, but there are even some scientific stuff that we have now won, and that everybody agrees that we've won, except that they haven't even heard of us doing that. And, you know, Ellen White's comments on health are some of the better ones for that particular example.
Another example, since you leaped into archaeology, I guess I can leap in. There's pretty good evidence that Sodom, the ancient city of Sodom, is not south of the Dead Sea, but maybe north of the Dead Sea, in a place called Tal el Hammam. And that now has a website devoted to it. There's a team of evangelical Christians excavating. They're in their seventh year now, and it's looking awfully good, and it fits the time of Abraham much better. So anyway, that's another case that may be vindicated, yeah, equally to Belshazzar. Not quite yet, but it may be.
Come in here and then back.
I was thinking about this from a slightly different point of view. If all these genomes of viruses and bacteria and various other pathogens are, shall we say, relatively rapidly losing their integrity, does it not stand to reason that at some point in not too distant future, that will reach the point where these pathogens will simply become self-limiting because of their degradation of their genetic integrity?
Basically become extinct.
They will become extinct. We've had extinctions of various other species. Why not extinctions of pathogens?
Well, of course, that would be the argument of John Sanford.
That's the way that information looks. But there comes this other point that has occurred to me while we were all carrying on this discussion. And doesn't the same pattern, the same development also follow for ideas? Ideas seem to go through permutations and mutations. Every time there is a challenge to a particular idea, it looks for a way to escape into yet another justification or rationalization, until at some point it has mutated so far that it is no longer even similar to the original from which it started. So I can see that at some point, with all the various stresses of evidences, the evolutionary thinking that Darwin first proposed will be hardly recognizable because of all these accretions of various explanations and justifications of how this or that could have happened in order to somehow salvage the theory. And ultimately, all that does is adds more mutations to the theory. Until one day, you can hardly recognize it for what it was to begin with, and it will just drift away into something else. And certainly, people may never actually concede defeat, but they will have changed so far that the future generations, what they call theory of evolution and what was originally considered as the evolution, the whole meaning of the word will have changed.
Well, of course, allows people to take advantage of that situation where evolution means one thing now, and it used to mean something else differently, and people will get people to agree to evolution in one sense and then use it in an entirely different sense. So, yes, you do see that kind of thing happening and people actually using it. But I agree with you that I think that truth theories actually gain strength as time goes on. And for example, Newton's theory of gravitation has had a change in the inside of it to become Einstein's theory of relativity. Maybe there'll be another one, you don't know. But what we can say for sure is that the inverse square law of attraction is going to be a part of that, whatever transformation happens. Because that's something that can be, you know, experimentally verified multiple times, and appears to be, if not universal, at least close enough to universal, that it can be considered such. On the other hand, I do think that there are theories that die the death of a thousand cuts, and I think that phlogiston theory is one of them. It's a nice theory. It explains this, but it doesn't explain this quite as well. It doesn't. Well, if you modify it, we can make it explain that. But eventually the modifications just became too great and people stopped learning the theory. I mean, it did actually make explanations for a while, but then eventually they failed. Will evolutionary theory ever get that way? I suspect that pure atheistic evolutionary theory will get that way. And what we'll be left with is a kind of a theistic evolution that can get around all of the problems by a God-did-it mechanism, but that can still maintain that it's been a long time, that death is part of the process, and that the six-day creation really isn't terribly important. And there'll be a bunch of other conclusions that will be apparently based on the theory, which in fact is kind of free floating on air, but because it doesn't really make any predictions, is not really falsifiable either. That's what I think will eventually happen. Anyway, come back next week. We'll have some more fun. And I guess I said in the email what I was thinking about doing.